Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Stone Key, written and read by Isobelle Carmody. For my brother Ken, who climbs mountains when you least expect. We travel the path of waves, which is full of contradictory currents and mysterious diversions. Part 1, The Song of Freedom. One. It ought to have felt momentous, going through the pass and seeing the highlands spread out in the pink-gold morning light. Momentous because, for the first time, I was riding down to a land that was free and where I need not hide who or what I was. Yet it was impossible to feel complacent or even secure, because soon, for the first time, land folk would vote for their leaders, who might undo all that the rebels had achieved since the council had been overthrown. And where would that leave misfits like me? The hatred and prejudice against us, which the council and herd of faction had encouraged, had not ended with their reign. The wrong leader could easily fan the flames of resentment and unease into a fire that might yet consume us. But as the rebel leader Dardellan had so often said, there could be no freedom if people were not able to choose their own leaders. I let my eyes rove along the neat line of trees that bordered Burgle's orchards on the left side of the road, trying to take comfort in their order. But my eyes were drawn inexorably to the other side of the road, where the ground dropped away steeply and suddenly into the dense, complex wilderness of the White Valley. I could see clear across the green treetops to the mountains that separated highland from lowland, Tor, Gelfort, and Emeraldfell, and to the blacklands that bordered the White Valley. It looked untouched and impenetrable, but I knew how many secrets lay hidden there. It was the way of things, I thought morosely, and it was better not to forget it. I lifted my face to the sky and closed my eyes, trying to focus on the warmth of the sun and on the sweet, green smell of spring. But too many worries crowded in. The looming elections, of course, and the forthcoming trial of the rebel Malik, as well as whatever was going on in Saithwold. But most of all, I was troubled by Marion's insistence that Dragon accompany us to Sutrium. The girl had been willing, because both the healer Keller and the old herbalist Caitlin were going. But Dragon's presence meant I must constantly face her fear of me. This was painful, because she had loved me once, but my invasion of her mind, which had been the only way to save her, had destroyed her trust in me. It had been a shock to discover that upon waking from her coma, Dragon had forgotten our friendship, forgotten my rescue of her from the Beforetime ruins where she had dwelt as a lonely urchin. I had believed Keller and the other healers when they said Dragon would remember in time, but she had not done so. She knew only that I was the bringer of pain, and so great was her fear of me that we had been unable to manage a single conversation since she had awakened. The truth was that I had proposed the expedition as much to get away from Dragon as to fulfill my promise to return the 20 families gypsy healer, Darius, to his people. Then Marion had cut through the discussion about what other uses could be made of the expedition to announce her support for it, because she foresaw trouble looming on the west coast and I would be needed to deal with it. Naturally, she offered no explanation and no details. She had added almost as an afterthought that Dragon must go to Sutrium. I felt a surge of anger and fear at the memory of her foretelling, for it had been just such a journey to Sutrium that had initiated the events that left Dragon in a dangerous coma. Yet a cooler voice reminded me that, without the coma and my journey into her mind to free her from it, I would not have realized that Dragon was the daughter of the murdered Queen of the Redland. And much as her fear and hatred distressed me, I now knew that something was locked in Dragon's memories that I would need to complete my secret quest to destroy the Beforetime weapon machines. Perhaps this journey to Sutrium was to be the means of learning what it was.
Why cannot Elspeth Inlay just accepting? Why always thinking, gnawing, trying to change the shape of things?
Maraman sent the acerbic query to me without shifting his languid position on Keller's lap in the wagon. If you are irritated by my thoughts, you could stay out of my mind, I sent back tartly. The old cat did not condescend to answer, but Keller gave me a sidelong look. She had no far-seeking abilities, but her healing empathy meant that she could not help but feel the emotions flowing between Maraman and me. She turned away at once, not wanting to pry, but the bleakness in her expression told me that her own thoughts were no more happily disposed than mine. Doubtless, she was thinking of Domic. He and Keller had been in love, but the coercer's spying during the rebellion had so tormented and divided him against himself that he had finally rejected her and Obernewtyn before disappearing under mysterious circumstances. Keller blamed herself, and I thought it was as much guilt as the desire to heal that was taking her to Sutrium. But I said nothing. Empathy was the one talent I lacked entirely, and its want made me awkward with emotions and reluctant to trust my own feelings, let alone anyone else's. Besides, what could I say to comfort her, unless it was true that misery loved company? One cannot flee from, avoid difficulties of life, Elspeth Inlay. But perhaps it is possible, necessary, to outrun them for a time. Gulf assent. I felt a rush of affection for his passionate nature and laid my hand on his sleek, black neck. The flesh quivered with impatience. The wagons are not made for speed, I sent regretfully. I, Galtha, am. We will gallop away and then return, he responded eagerly. With a laugh, I told Keller that we would scout ahead. Galtha neighed to Welt and Balia, who drew the wagon, then cantered to the lead wagon where the young Farseeker Zarak sat on the foremost bench with Louis Larkin. Zaid and Lo whinnied a welcome to Galtha as I explained I would ride ahead for a time. Dragon was in the back of the wagon with the plump old herbalist Caitlin and one of the two injured soldier guards who we were transporting to Sutrium. The other lay on the floor of the second wagon. "It's a perfect day for a ride," Zarak said wistfully. As though his words were a signal, Gultha sprang away. If I had not learned from hard experience that he loved to leap into a gallop like this, I would have tumbled backwards over his rump. I tangled one hand in his mane and caught the thick black whip of my plait with the other. His joy steamed off his body as heat and a kind of vibration that filled me with an answering exhilaration. How many times had we ridden like this in the high mountains, sharing the rush and the wild freedom of our speed? My muscles soon protested, reminding me of how seldom I had ridden of late. My duties as guildmistress at Obernewtyn left little time for self-indulgence. Fleetingly, all the weight of that role pressed on me anew, but then the sheer physical demands of the ride emptied me of thought. I let myself merge with Gulfer until I was no more than an extension of the powerful black horse racing along the road. It was a reckless pace, but the way was clear well ahead, and there were seldom walkers on the lonely stretch between the turnoff to Burgold's orchards and the pass into the mountains. Aside from the fact that the ground and walls of the pass were streaked with poisons dangerous to the naked flesh, there was also the rumour that plague had destroyed Obernewtyn, which had been enough to discourage the curious. Of course, the rebel leaders now knew that Obernewtyn was intact and home to our misfit community, and I had no doubt that knowledge of our refuge was spreading into the wider community. Even so, I doubted we would have many casual visitors. Rounding a slight bend in the road, Gulfus stopped and reared suddenly, almost unseating me. I lurched violently onto his neck and saw that a whole section of the ridge had broken away to crumble down into the white valley, taking a chunk of the road with it. What remained was narrow and badly eroded on one side, and though it would still serve a walker or a careful rider, the wagons could not possibly pass along it. I slipped to the ground, aware the landslide must be recent, since the messenger from Sutrium had not mentioned it when he visited Obernewtyn a mere 7 day ago. "Damn," I muttered. In drier weather we might simply have run the wheels along the verge, but this soon after thaw, the ground was soggy and the wagons would sink to their axles. I sent Gulfer back to warn the others and began to cast about for boughs and flat stones. After the black horse had galloped off, I laboured in silence, laying a border to increase the width of the road on its inner edge. The passage between Gwannet and the mountain pass that led to Obernewtyn had been eroding ever since I had first travelled along it years back as a sentenced misfit. Since we had taken over Obernewtyn, the Techno Guild had spoken many times of the need to repair it, but they had done nothing for fear of drawing unwanted attention to the valley. For this reason, travel into the White Valley had always been limited to small expeditions on foot or horseback. It was only in recent times that discreet ramps for wagons had been created from scree. It was hot, muddy work, but I found myself enjoying the simplicity of the makeshift repairs. I tried to imagine a life in which no more than this was required of me, and then realized that such an existence could seem desirable only to one who did not have to do it all the time. The truth was that I enjoyed being mistress of a guild at Obernewtyn, despite all the meetings and negotiations and the sheer amount of talk it required. My role would change now, though, for there was no longer any need to rescue misfits. When the wagons arrived, Louis, Keller, and Zarak alighted at once to sigh and shake their heads before unhitching the horses. Dragon climbed down too, casting me a look of violent blue-eyed dislike. As Marrowman leapt down beside her and pressed himself against her legs, I wondered somewhat bitterly why she did not feel any antipathy for the old cat, since I had only been able to invade her mind with his help. Caitlin and Darius elected to remain in the wagons and watch over the soldier guards, but Garth descended after an argument with himself over whether or not to bother. Once he saw the broken road, though, he began to mutter about this shoring up technique and that stress. It took us 2 hours to widen the road enough for the wagons to pass. Caitlin suggested we eat mid-meal before continuing, but I did not want to stop until we had reached the White Valley. The habit of caution was strong, and given what the Sutrium messenger had said about robber bands terrorizing remote holdings, I deemed it wiser not to break that habit just yet. Admittedly, the messenger had been referring to the upper lowlands, but it was possible that robbers might roam higher. When we set off, Dragon sat beside Louis Larkin, with Marrowman perched contentedly and rather smugly on her lap. Zarak now rode Zayd, for despite being a mare, Lo was large and strong, and she had no difficulty in pulling a wagon alone. Leaving Zarak and Zayd to accompany the lead wagon, I dropped behind to speak to Keller, but she had climbed into the back to help Darius tend to the injured soldier guard whose bandages had been dislodged. My feelings towards the soldier guards were ambivalent. Being in our care all through the wintertime had forced them to see us as other than the monstrous freaks that the council had painted us, but these men had killed people and horses I had known and cared for. Rushton, ever focused on the present, had said the most important thing was that they had all agreed to tell the new council of chieftains exactly what had happened in the White Valley when Malik had betrayed us. It had also been Rushton who had suggested that since I required 2 wagons, I should use them to take the soldier guards to Sutrium. They were not entirely recovered, but the fact that both Keller and Darius would travel with us meant they would be well cared for, and by travelling now, they would have time to recover from the journey before the trial. Garth spoke, interrupting my thoughts, to suggest that given the delay, we might as well spend the night at the Techno Guild encampment in the White Valley.
"You'll never reach Rangorn before night now, and Marion did not urge particular haste, did she?"
"Marion would never be so hasty as to urge haste," I said dryly. "She said only that there was danger on the west coast, and that I am needed to deal with it.
I do not see how, since the ships that the rebels were building to get to the west coast have been destroyed. Dardellan's message said there is now no chance of landing a force on the west coast for at least another half year.
Not a force, I said, but I am sure that Dardellan's request for a plast suit means he will try to send a spy across the Sugradoon. We were transporting two of the fragile plast suits, which the Techno Guild had made during the wintertime. One was for Dardellan, and the other was a gift of thanks for the leader of the 20 families.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.